Hello, everybody. Welcome to episode 4 of The Wild Beyond. My name is Ethan. I am your humble dungeon master for this evening. I am joined by 5 incredibly talented, wonderful people. Say hello, wonderful people.
Hello, wonderful people.
Oh, I'm so glad we're not stealing bits from any famous streams. First things first. Welcome, everyone who is in the chat. We appreciate you being here so much, getting to share. I know, at least speaking personally, one of my favorite things in the entire world, and I know a few of you quite well, and I know that that is on your list as well, so thank you for joining and sharing this passion with us. Before we get started, few announcements. These are the same announcements that I give every single time. It's really only one. This is an 18-plus stream. That is for language, adult content, and drug use, both on camera and in game, potentially. Don't worry, only where it is legal to do so. Don't get on our asses, Twitch. With that said, before we jump in, I want everyone who has some swag, if you want to display your swag, even though mine is mirrored. It says Deadlifts and Dragons, got the Beswolder here with the Monster Gains Manual. This is from Flex Comics. I love these guys. If you are a geeky gym rat like me, like Lauren, like Devin, these have... I mean, you're all geeks, but I don't know if you constitute gym rats. No offense. We're the meatheads.
We're sick with it.
Is it meatheads on the top and couch potatoes on the bottom?
Apparently it's meatheads on the top. You know, but I love Flex Comics. If you like geeky gym puns, they are my go-to, legitimately about 50% of my closet. Any other swag? Any other swag for tonight?
I just have something to say.
Oh no.
So.
Oh dear.
Hi everybody.
Oh god. Oh no.
Is anything supposed to happen to me when I take that mushrooms?
Like, fine. Weird. Maverick starts with an extra luck point. God, are you planning on keeping that in the whole time?
I was.
I really hope you do.
I am. I'm keeping it all in the whole time.
I'm very interested to see how it impacts your voice.
Oh, I practiced with it. I've been practicing with it.
Of course.
Great.
Of course.
I did that all last night. It's great. It makes it even better and helps me out with it. Also, I have, because of my trippy experience now, I have a new pen, and it's a mushroom.
Oh, that's nice!
Oh, so please tell me the plan is to deck the whole vest out with relevant pins.
So, the gold star one that Rot gave me comes tomorrow, and it says you tried.
Well, don't worry, I think I've got your next one here.
That's fitting. That is very fitting.
Be gay and do crimes.
Yes.
Soon that might be very appropriate.
Join us.
Maverick, beautiful. Start with one extra luck point.
Yay!
Amazing.
Morgan, you still rocking the Nat 1 shirt?
I am pre-recorded.
I have one shirt. Bodhi is...
an octopus on a bicycle.
Fantastic. Devin's just rocking some Gromp attire. And Bodhi is Bodhi.
He's Grumpy.
Bodhi.
And the last piece of my attire, I just got my nails redone. Look how shiny those are.
Yeah, it's slay.
Mermaid effect.
They're like a cat. They're like a cat's eye. It's super cool. They use like a magnet to do it.
Yeah. There is legitimately nothing I love more than, other than D&D and my beautiful wife and family and friends, than being at a very right-wing gym that people stare at the dude with the painted nails and then lifting more than those fuckers. Nothing gives me more pleasure.
Come on, fight me, I dare you.
That might be toxic masculinity. I hope it's not, but... fuck that.
I think it's in the right direction.
It's in the right direction. It's using toxic masculinity in a positive direction, I suppose. Well, with swag and welcomes and greetings out of the way, please sit back, grab yourself a drink, do some laundry, and leave us in the background. Whatever you're doing, Smallville, Sally Quinn, all you people in the chat, drop a hello so that we can say hello to you on break. But we are going to jump in. Last we left at the Witchlight Carnival, two Witchlight hands and three visitors were making their way through, don't do it, making their way through the carnival. Each had their own reason, their own goal, but there was one uniting goal shared among the entire group, and that is to find something called a Fey Crossing, a way of getting from the material plane here to the Fey Wild, specifically to a part of the Fey realm called Prismere. All of these individuals know that there is a Fey Crossing somewhere in the carnival. They have been told this by repeated and very trusted sources. Where still remains a mystery. Thanks to some very helpful unicorns on a carousel, however, we got a little bit more information. We found out the name of the hag that has at least one of Bodhi's lost things, Scabatha. We found out that Zabilna, the Archfey, the patron of the warlock Madric who hired Gromp and Rot, Zabilna is trapped in time, and her realm has been split amongst the three hags into partitions known as Hither, Thither, and Yon. We also learned that Mr. Witch and Mr. Light... Oh, we lost someone. Hold on. You're back. Don't do that. Was it a cat? Was it a cat? God! Cats.
You just blame all of our technical difficulties on cats.
The funny part is Sonic. For 4 out of 5 of you, I believe it. but found out that Mr. Witch and Mr. Light almost certainly know where the Fey Crossing is. And with the 5 of you heading to the shared bunk, the shared wagon that Otto sleeps in, with having some personal conversation and the giving of small tokens of affection, including some mushrooms off of Bodhi's back to Otto. When we last left, the lights of the Witchlight Carnival dimmed and raised, dimmed and raised, in a signal that Gromp and Otto especially know is an indication that the Big Top Extravaganza is about to begin. And the Big Top Extravaganza is the middle of the evening. It is the midpoint of the carnival day. And it is a experience not to be missed. So where we last left, with you all still in the staff area, you departed from Otto's cart and started heading back towards the wall of thorns, of brambles, that separates the staff area and its carts from the rest of the carnival. The Big Top itself... The Big Top itself is visible from where you are because the staff area is located directly behind the Big Top, and the colossal tent is quite visible. The lights inside kaleidoscopic and seeming to be flying around inside. It is now roughly about 1 a.m. With dusk having come at 8 p.m. and that being close to opening. So it is now about 11 p.m. or 12. And that, with the calls from the barkers and the stall runners encouraging the patrons to attend the Big Top Extravaganza, is where we pick up with you all.
You guys ready to go?
Where?
Well, to the Big Top of Extravaganza, of course.
How did you know that was going to be starting soon? Was it the lights?
Witchcraft.
Also, just it's about that time when it starts.
Oh. Oh, I see. It's probably... I don't have a watch. I don't know if watches exist.
Yeah, they do.
Okay. No, yeah. I really just go off body time. But if we want to get good seats, we better go pretty soon.
Well, then move it. I want the best seat in the house, man. You got the inside line on the best digs.
Oh, you already know. I want to sit somewhere that's not behind Bodhi.
We'll sit in the front. I'll see if I can make it happen. At least I'll try. But we gotta hurry. And I'll start moving.
I just have this image of the poor tiny little rot, and then just the huge shell. Yeah, Morgan?
Is there any food on the way there that I can quickly grab?
Between here and there, no, because as you step out of step towards the wall of brambles, they separate once again once Otto or Gromp gets within 5 feet. And the big tent is literally right there. That said, it's not a far walk to some food if you're wanting it, like legitimately 60 seconds.
Yeah, but big tent, flashing lights.
I can save you a seat.
I want to go in.
There is a small stall, just about, 40 feet away, that according to the sign, sells tree sap lollipops.
Are you interested in,
after? Okay.
Melon showed self-control with food? Guys, character growth is beautiful.
Oh god, oh, it's so hard.
So proud of you.
Is there anything needed to do to get in, or it's just a...
This is a... Tent. So the Big Top Extravaganza is not a ticketed event. As long as you have bought admission to the carnival, you can attend. It doesn't cost a punch. Right.
Out of character, I just really love that Otto's rabbit ears have gone semi-transparent and look like a little rabbit halo. Like a little angel.
Legit, when I saw them at first, I thought they were like part of a background effect because of how transparent they are. They're spectral bunny ears.
It's like a rabbit angel halo.
It's genuinely fantastic. Like, that's exactly... If I could have everyone wear costumes that were semi-translucent a character, that would be amazing. Oh, bring it. Bring it.
I would, but it's expensive on Etsy.
Make you something, don't worry.
Got a lion tail back here. Chip it to you.
I need a mane, not a tail. I've got like a make nub. You something. It's like that long.
Oh yeah, Melon has a little nub tail. It's...
Yeah. Talk about your nub!
So, are you all heading into the tent?
Yes!
This tent is colossal. And as you enter, you see rows of tiered benches encircling the main ring of the Big Top. And when you step inside, there is a unique, distinctive smell. And anyone who has been to a carnival inside the big tent knows exactly what I'm talking about. While this particular one has a little bit more sugary smells, there is that smell of sawdust, of animal sweat, of cotton candy and buttered popcorn, the smell of the wood benches, all mingling into this unique signature scent of the Big Top. There are colorful orbs of light that dance right near the top next to the central pole, creating a kaleidoscope of light and shadow. And the way the lights are moving seem innately organic. Not strobe lighting, but like dancing.
What do you guys think? Pretty nice, huh?
It has a weird smell.
You get used to it after a while.
There is a little goblin walking by who has a, gestures hat on with exaggeratedly large bells and is carrying a stand full of actually the tree sap lollipops.
Yes. Interested in a sweet thing?
Yes.
That'll be one ticket punch.
Trades you, and these, there are several different shapes, and you get to pick your design of choice. Never mind. It apparently, the first one is snatched and already deep in the maw.
Amazing.
None of you even got to see which one he grabbed. It was a blur of ticket exchange, one single swift motion.
Done.
The goblin had gotten about two steps away, and you say done, and
Well, you know what? That was impressive enough here. On the house, or on the tent.
I would say you get used to watching it after a while, but you really don't.
There we go.
Kind of fun.
I thoroughly enjoy it.
Impressive, man.
I'll wave him down. Can I actually have one? I'll hand a ticket.
Oh, Gromby, you know you don't have to do that here. just
to see him do it again.
Oh, I'll stay in watch, actually.
Uh-oh.
You owe him money already?
There's something...
looking at you, Rot, noticing the connection.
Does the sugar do anything to him, or is he just immune to it after all of this?
I tend not to feed him sugar. So I don't know.
Oh.
We're going to find out together.
Well, this will be the perfect event for that, and maybe after you're done here, something like snail racing to burn off the sugar rush.
Or a couple of laps around the fair.
Enjoy the extravaganza! Tree sap lollipops!
He's always so nice.
He's a good guy. And by the way, Otto, how are you feeling? Because have those kicked in yet, or you still feeling okay?
I'm gonna look at Gromp. And you know those old, like, 1950 cartoons like Betty Boop? That's all I see. I see everyone.
On that note, I don't want to shut you down. I'm loath to do so. But first, could you roll me a percentile die? Each time you succeed, or fail, depending on how you look at it, to see whether or not it has taken effect, it will be a greater chance of it taking effect the next time until the odds are 100%. Right now, there is a 20% chance, because it has only been about 15 minutes, so it depends 30. On your metabolism. 30? You're still... You can't notice any effects, as of yet.
I feel all right now.
Okay,
good. Life was really good, though.
Maybe we'll have to get some more once the show starts.
Thinking we're going to make another ticket run at this rate.
All right, yeah, only one ticket.
I have more.
Well, considering how many lollipops you are all going through, you're going to use them all up before the end of the show.
That's the perks of having someone that works here with you. Free pops all night, except for Melon.
Yup.
What?
Melon, you're too expensive.
I tell him that every day.
I still don't know what that means.
An expensive date?
So, question for you all. As you were having this conversation and Melon is licking the third popsicle stick completely clean, just the long lion tongue just scratching every last bit of sugar off of there. Where are you all sitting? So it is a round tent, so I don't mean where in terms of 360, but it is multiple rows of tiered benches. Are you all wanting to be up top, down close, in the middle? What's the plan?
Let's get close.
I tried taking them to the front, if possible. Front row.
Absolutely. Normally reserved for VIPs, but the Minotaur, who is working there currently... His horns probably going up to just shy of 8 feet, just is standing there in a performatively intimidating stance, so that it's not actual intimidating, but it's that over the top no one shall enter, and sees the two of you.
You work in the show tonight?
No, we have the day off, actually. It's great.
You know, someone mentioned that you had the day off. I didn't, never heard of a day off.
And he does a very stereotypical bull snort.
Well, how about this? If you're all right with me and Grump and our friends here sitting up here, I can put in a word for you. Probably to Mr. Lott.
And he gives a low bow, coming as low as he can to your level while stepping back.
The pleasure is mine, Mr. Otto. Enjoy the show, everybody.
Thanks, Dwayne. And,
save some gains for the rest of us.
And he gives himself a little slap and, oh, actually. So as you all...
Rot after you.
What manners? Sweeps down the line.
No, the, right after, probably.
As Rot walks by, eventually, Dwayne catches... You did say Dwayne, right, Otto? Dwayne catches you, Otto.
Does your friend there need a booster seat? We've got some.
Well... Actually, can you get two? One for me and one for her, please.
Yes, no problem. No problem.
Thank you.
And just a minute or so later, just pulling these out of a curtained area, he walks over with what look like two mushroom marshmallows, about yay big.
There you go. One for each of you.
Thanks, Wayne.
What's this?
It's the booster seat.
There's a booster seat. You know, I got you into the second row, but this row will fill up here, and I want you to be able to see everything, you know? I didn't mean no offense by it. I can take it back. You don't have to have it. You know what? That's on me. I'm sorry. I was presumptuous here. I'll take
No, actually, Dwayne, it might be useful to keep them. Just, Rot, you're going to want it.
Look, how about this? I'm gonna leave this right here, and I'm going to step out of this conversation.
There are actual sparks coming out of her snout.
If you prefer, we could call it something else, like a make taller seat, slightly bigger seat, not super short seat, makes you slightly taller.
Or a princess throne.
I am tall enough. How dare you? I've never been so...
As Rot fumes, the crowd begins to fill in the remaining seats. There is a... Oh, Bodhi.
Bodhi will scoot in last, and as he's like, excuse me, man, sorry, excuse me, coming through here, sorry. He's sensing the tension of the people around him due to his size. And he looks around, he looks from side to side, he looks at his friends, whoever's next to him. Hey man, I'm just gonna make this a little easier for everyone back there. And he's gonna suck into his shell, where the shell part, this part's on the ground, but he does that weird turtleneck thing.
So he can see. On the back of the shell?
Pretty much. So he's laying on the back of the shell and he just does that neck thing. So he's the perfect ability to see without
impairing.
Please
make me, as you tilt back, being a curved surface that you don't have muscular full control over, please make me a quick acrobatics check. Or rather, dexterity saving throw. It's a low DC.
They're both minus one, so...
If we're in the second row, maybe he can use his little nubbins to brace against the seat in front of him.
I think Ron and I are both looking at this like, what the
fuck? Horror.
What'd you get?
A four.
Just fall directly into the row where people are walking behind you.
Oh, Otto, help me take care of this.
Melon.
Can you get that?
And you just hear from inside the shell, I was just trying to be considerate, man.
It's all right. It's all right. It's all right. Melon, can you help us, please?
Melon, please, dear God.
Oh, okay.
Nice having him around.
He sticks his leg nubs out. Oh, thanks, guys. I could have done it, but thanks. Appreciate it. So instead, what he's going to do is he's going to suck his legs into his shell so that he gets a little shorter. He's still quite large, but he's just a little shorter. Okay, that's the best I can do, guys. I hope that's okay, man.
It's only at this point, Bodhi, as you're looking behind you apologetically, you realize that there are two rows of the VIP section. And then there's a bit of a walking path, and then the general section. There is no row directly behind you whose vision you would be blocking.
I'm just going to pretend I didn't see that and choose to think I did a good thing. Good job, Booty.
I'm kind of hoping that I actually am blocking someone. Because fuck them.
Just like damn. Stand up on your tiptoes.
Now I'm just imagining Melling with a crazy long torso, but short legs.
No.
The lights of the big tent dim. A hush of anticipation falls over the crowd as the soft whispers of curious children and adults along murmur through the air. The air is still thick with that buttery smell of popcorn and the sugary sweetness of cotton candy and pixie tops. And as the hush falls further, the only sound remaining, the occasional, what's gonna happen, Mom? Shh, 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 shh. A beam of light illuminates the center of the ring, and standing there already as the light appears, an elven figure sitting in a silver hoop, the hoop itself suspended over the center of the ring by silk ropes. He wears a dazzling suit of diamond pane mirrors and a pair of butterfly wings. His scepter is topped with a spinning vane that calmly rotates as the figure basks in the hushed gasps and murmurs. Otto and Gromp, you know who this is. And Bodhi, can you make me a history check? Kitty.
Twelve.
That's a little too low for how far this is. However, I will say that this individual looks kind of familiar to you. The two of you,
dude, this guy looks super familiar.
You know that this is Mr. Light. Welcome, one and all, to this evening's extravaganza. I am Mr. Light. Prepare to be transported to a realm of pure delight and wonder, where dreams are woven into reality and magic swirls like stardust. And as he says, like stardust, the ring begins to climb out of sight of the spotlight, which expands to now cover the whole central ring. As he rises, he continues to speak. We begin with a classic of the genre. One might even call it a cliché, but some things are clichés and classics for a reason, and this is no exception. Ladies, gentlemen, gentlefolk, gather round for a display of raw might and power. Prepare to be astonished by the astonishing strength of a true force of nature, I proudly present to you the one, the only, Burly! Stepping forward is Burly the Bugbear. Burly takes the center ring, where barbells with round ends, stones with chains drilled through them, boulders, iron bars, and more are all laid out in eager anticipation. Burly himself is wearing overalls. He has removed the top half that he has tied around him like a belt, revealing coarse, dense muscles under his hairy frame. On top of his head, he wears half a pumpkin, like a helmet, which he, as he steps to the center,
respect.
As he steps to the center and he hikes up his overalls a little bit, he pulls the pumpkin down and kind of grinds it onto his head as a stuntman might before performing a difficult trick. He steps over to one of the enormous barbells with the spherical ends. You know exactly what strongman barbells I'm describing. And he begins to warm up with it, hitting every muscle a little bit as the audience, you know, is kind of like giving some applause. It's not that impressive for him to just warm up. But as he drops the warm-up barbell, he steps over and begins the main act. With roars that reverberate through the tent, he lifts boulders and bends iron bars, at one point sticking a bar against the center of his throat and stepping into it to bend it. The crowd erupts in thunderous applause for his final act as he lifts a chair above his head, while balanced atop the chair are a dozen acrobats who get progressively smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller as they rise a dozen high. As he presses the chair over his head with one arm, bringing the pixie at the top close to scraping the roof of the tent, the audience cheers and applauds and erupts as everyone, from top to bottom like a wave, does a bow, which is impressive considering some of the acrobats are balancing on their hands, some of the acrobats are standing atop shoulders while balancing others on theirs, and Burly, supporting all of this with one hand, manages to do a bow and then rise. As they all boom, 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 one after another descend from the tower and do one final half-circle bow, the first act of the Big Top Extravaganza concludes.
Getting to watch this from here is so much better.
I'd like to lean around and look at Melon and go, no, I know what you're thinking. Stop thinking it right now.
How can you do that?
I can read your mind. And then telepathically, I'm going to go, I'm in your mind. It's empty in here.
I mean, yes, you are correct.
Melon, who are you talking to?
He's thinking myself. About getting a chair and making me stand on it, I can tell.
Yeah.
That'd be kind of cool to see, though.
No, it wouldn't.
I mean,
don't encourage him.
You can stand in my back.
Want to stand on any of you. I'm fine on the ground. I can even see. Look, I didn't need a booster seat.
Are you enjoying yours?
I'm just going to look at Rot with my feet dangling. I'm having fun.
Speaking of, Otto, can you roll me a percentile check? Just let me know if it is under 50 or over 50.
70?
70. Let me check something. Lauren, not Bodhi. Lauren.
Yes.
Actually, I guess it should be Bodhi. Bodhi, Can you describe the effects as this dose starts to kick in for Otto?
From a scientific or cerebral level, or are you looking about the layman's terms about what you're going to experience side effect wise?
That one.
Oh, cool, my man. Okay, so what I gave you was a little slice of the first mushroom I ever grew my back in the Feywilds. It was to help me ground myself in my new environment. It is a micro dose of that particular mushroom, my dude. So what you are going to experience is a heightened sense of oneness with yourself and your environment. And in this beautiful transcendental experience that you're having both inside yourself and outside yourself simultaneously, you are going to have a heightened sense of your surroundings, but in a good way, such as, but not limited to, things tasting just a little bit sweeter if they're already sweet. Seeing colors slightly more vibrantly than you would usually see them, though on the same spectrum. Or hearing music, it just feels good in your ear holes. Stuff like that, man. I mean, you're not like gonna be tripping balls seeing God or anything like that, though we can do that later. I wanted to start you off with a small dose, get a baseline for adaptation further. So that's what you should be experiencing, my dude. As long as you came with a full stomach.
And those effects combined with the positive influence of your welcome gift, that golden sycamore seed, that left you and Melon just in great moods. How are you feeling right now, Otto?
Honestly, this is probably the happiest I've ever felt before. My fur feels so soft. It feels so soft. Like if you touch me, I wonder if it feels so soft to you too, because it's like, I take care of my fur really great, but like—
Are you saying all this out loud? Soft. I really hope
Yeah,
so.
I am. Fantastic. I am. Like, I'm really soft.
Bodhi is listening.
Like, but like, meeting you, Rod, and Grump, wait, I already met Grom. I met Melon. Like, everybody here is great. Like, this is the best day off ever. And, like, I can smell everything even better than normal. Like, the colors, it looks like a rainbow that's kind of whipping around and everything. And just the music makes my ears, like, perk up and tingle. It's so great.
Hey, I said that a mile a minute, too,
by the way.
Hey, Rob. Yeah.
He's just going to pat him on the head.
Is this what you called a stroke?
Oh, your hands feel so good.
I am going to cast a message, and only for you, Otto, you hear, "This is God. You are going to have the best night of your life tonight." And I am covering my mouth while I'm saying this. "You're going to have so much fun tonight. It's going to be the best night ever. Get ready." How you doing, Otto?
What? I'm... Did you hear that?
Hear what?
There was a voice talking to him. He was real nice.
Oh, listen to that voice in your head, man. I swear, if you're hearing it already,
He was saying, or I guess it was a he. I don't know. They were saying that I'm going to have a great time tonight, and it's great. I already am. But, yeah. Bodhi, your hands are really soft.
Thanks, man. Appreciate it. I moisturize pretty regularly. Got a poultice I make myself from a couple of these mushrooms here on my back. Anyway,
Rot, you were...
You're good.
You were saying something. I believe at one point.
I think she started to reply to Melon, and then this kept going on, and the thought just, like, flew out of her brain like a butterfly, and she's leaning, because she's first in line, then it's Melon, and she's leaning around Melon to kind of watch this happen, just with these, like, glowing yellow eyes, just like...
You know what I'll do? I'll literally get up and swap with you so you can watch more. Oh.
She said, no, I'm good here.
Okay.
Don't want to be any closer to them.
Oh.
Be right back, guys. Oh, and I run away. I run real quick.
He's so fast.
I can't stop watching either.
Are you running somewhere far?
Not far.
How long do you think it'll take you to be back?
3 minutes.
Okay. As Gromp runs off, just about 20 or just about 15 or 20 seconds after Burly has finished his performance, the voice of Mr. Light comes through once again as he descends and begins slowly spinning, now in a different posture, kind of reclining against the hoop and twirling his scepter around his hand. What a beast he is, folks. But for every shadow, there is light. For every night, a day. And for every beast, a beauty. Ladies, gentlemen, gentlefolk, prepare to be transported to a realm of enchantment and serenity. I implore you, open your hearts and lend your ears to the mesmerizing melodies of the one who dwells beneath the ocean's depths. I present to you, and as he says this, Burly, who had finished, tossing his stuff aside, walks slightly off of the center and starts to drag over his shoulder via a rope a large cart, or a small decorated cart, atop of which is an enormous closed clamshell. And as he leaves the ring, the main spotlight shining and glinting upon the shell, Mr. Light finishes. Palasha the Mermaid. Rising once again, a hush of anticipation falling over the crowd. There's this quiet, haunting song that can be heard. So soft at first that members of the audience whisper to one another, unsure if their minds were playing tricks on them. Then slowly, drawing out the moment only as an experienced performer can, the clamshell begins to open and the song grows louder. A voice like gold wrapped in velvet. As the shell fully opens, it reveals iridescent waters and a mermaid swimming within. Her body and scales go from light blue to deep purple. She has gold-painted eyelids, gold belts around her waist, and long, drifting fins. As she's fully revealed, the song she was singing finishes. The crowd, you all included, silent for a moment, not wanting that song to be over. But as she waits, the audience applauds. And then quickly falls silent once again, as if afraid to sully the silence with their sounds. When she begins...
holy shit, guys, did I miss anything? Sorry, I'll be quiet.
As you say that, just a shh from a few people nearby.
Shh.
When she begins to sing again, the air becomes thick with a sense of tranquility. Many of the audience members let out soft, contented sighs as their muscles relax and their minds drift away from here. Could all of you make me wisdom saves?
What if I'm looking for food and not paying attention?
Still, then with advantage.
Okay.
At disadvantage.
Oh, definitely.
Fuck yeah, let's go.
You're lucky I'm letting you roll.
11.
Okay.
21.
12.
17. I wrote a nat 1. Let's nat go. One.
So, interestingly, Rotto.
I am Rotto.
Rot and Melon, you are the two who... You are still as affected by this music as you believe your character would be. But the other three of you are affected with an additional sense, and that is your sights. And when you open your eyes again, you see sights of the deep ocean. Fish that are transparent and bioluminescent that wave like flags through the waters. Leviathans of sizes that dwarf your ability to fully grasp. Lights from algae and creatures that create a starscape beneath the water. But for all of you, time itself seems to slow as Palasha sings. As if time itself was unwilling to rush this perfect moment. And as Palasha reaches the crescendo of her final song, and then holds the final note, the musical accompaniment falling away, the note is filled with intense emotion. Grump, what emotion is it to you? What, as it draws forth the most currently relevant emotion?
It's like pure whimsy and kind of fear.
Rot, what about you?
Strange sort of craving.
There is a very real sense of longing in that note. Otto?
Feels unbridled happiness. Like, it feels like the sun is inside him and just keeping him warm. Even though he looks like he's in the ocean, he's at peace. And it just makes his heart feel bigger.
Melon.
Melon never really fully understood music and the aesthetic of it, so right now it's more uncertainty.
And Bodhi.
He's feeling pretty contented. He's getting a visual and auditory massage. That's what it feels like to him.
And as the final note dies, the audience delays on applauding as everyone is kind of shaken from their reverie by the first applause that then builds around the tent until it is roaring for Palasha. The clamshell closes. And the decorated cart, there it is. And the decorated cart begins to get pulled away.
This is the best experience I've ever had.
Do you think when you kiss her, she tastes like fish?
Oh, I don't know. You're going to have to try.
That was... magical.
This is actually probably one of the first times you've gotten to see both of you this full performance. You don't have a part to play in the Big Top Extravaganza, so you've normally been left working your booths.
Best day off ever.
Although honestly, I can't tell you how jealous I am of you right now.
Why?
I've never seen you smile this big in my entire life.
Otto's gonna notice how big his actual smile is at this point. Oh! Well, I got new friends, I got a day off with my best bud, and I get to see, like, other things that our job entails. Like, I got voices in my head now, apparently, but it's great, you know? And I'm just, I'm happy for what the future holds for us, Gronk. Like,
and you have this. And I pull out from my pocket a ball that is red and gold that I had run off to go get. I got this for you. And I know I got you this like 10 minutes ago, but I wanted you to have it.
I got two balls.
You remember that one point I gave you at the start of the session, Maverick?
Yeah.
Nah, I'm kidding. That was a good joke.
Thank you, Gronk.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Oh, no, I have something for you. Hold on.
Is this getting a little too sweet for you, too?
I do not know how to feel.
Otto's just looking at you at this point. Really? I can hear you.
Maybe it's the voice in your head.
It's not. That one doesn't sound as sassy as yours.
The voice in his head is really fucking cool. Just saying. Yeah. It's really cool. I assume.
I'm going to take the handkerchief or the bandana that I had around my neck, and actually, because it's tiny, I'm going to make it into a pocket square for Gronk. There you go, bud.
You didn't have to do this. Come on.
I am in a good mood right now, and I'm rolling real high, and it's feeling great. I feel like the sun has hugged me and has not let me go. And it's feeling wonderful. You know that perfect day in the summertime or in the fall when it's like a nice little breeze, but it's still cold, but it's a nice warm breeze, but not overly hot? That's what I feel like right now.
Honestly, I don't... That's kind of how you look like right now.
Huh? Bodhi!
Yeah?
Do you still do this all the time? I'm feeling great. Do you do this all the time?
In varying degrees. Sometimes with differing outcomes. But, yeah. It's my favorite way to find myself, you know?
I think I'm finding myself.
Lean into it, my dude. You deserve to be happy. Find you happy.
Hey, and he's going to pat you on the head.
Oh, dude, you're so soft.
Holy shit, you are soft.
Did you just say that? I'm sorry, did you say that he's soft?
Yeah, his hands feel real soft.
You're soft, but in like a very soft way. That's cool. I mean, you do take excellent care of your fur. I mean, it's pretty...
Thanks.
If you didn't already have a gold star, I'd probably give you a fucking other one, man.
I be honest with you, I really like the gold star.
Yeah. I don't think she gives him out very often.
No. Yeah. Rot, I also want to thank you for it.
I only have a couple. I have to, like, be selective with them.
That makes sense. You don't want to just be, like, flying out gold stars, because then you don't mean anything, man.
Hey, Ethan?
Hmm.
Has anybody else with, like, a mobile food thing kind of even remotely come close?
There is in the in-between, the quick intermission between these acts, which is very short. There is someone walking around selling some candied apples.
Doesn't matter. I'm getting one.
Another stick-like items to add to your list. Mark a punch off.
One.
And as Melon gets his next bite of food, once again, the voice
Gentlefolk, for every beast of beauty, and for every note of perfect agony and bliss, there is a silence, deep and profound as a mother's love. Prepare yourselves for a moment of captivating silence, where laughter, tears, and the purest form of expression will transcend words. It is with utmost pleasure that I present to you a master of the art of pantomime, a silent maestro who weaves tales with gestures and emotion alone. Give a warm welcome to the enigmatic performer, the one who paints invisible worlds and elicits a symphony of emotions. Candlefoot the Clown!
After he's done with this introduction, can I nudge Ra? It's like, hey, what's a pantsmime?
I have no idea.
That's what he heard. He heard pantsmime.
Oh, you guys are about to find out.
Bodhi, that name is familiar to you. I will say even without a check.
Oh, yeah.
Candlefoot was someone you remember, who when you were just a wee Bodhi, when you first came to the carnival chasing after your friend, Juniper the Owlbear, it was to Candlefoot that she ran. It was with Candlefoot that you found her. It was with Candlefoot that you spoke. And walking out to the center ring is someone familiar, actually, to all of you. You saw this particular clown as he silently welcomed you to the Hall of Illusions.
Oh.
His outfit is not simply monochrome, not simply blacks and whites, but a veritable rainbow of grays that makes him look, rather than black and white, desaturated. As Candlefoot emerges, walking out onto the into the center ring, he waves to the audience and trips and falls, falling into a roll as he springs forward, to the delight of children big and small. It worked for Willy Wonka, it works for Candlefoot. The first half of Candlefoot's act, classic vaudeville, with Candlefoot attempting to retrieve and don a bowler hat from such impossible to reach locations as his foot and the end of a broomstick. Each attempt is a glorious and dismal failure as he reaches up to the hat at the end of the broomstick, but also finds himself lifting the broomstick in the process, it always staying mere millimeters out of reach. As he fails again and again in the most absurd ways, guffaws and cackles from all around. After finally placing, Rot, was there something? Just tapping. After finally placing his precious hat atop his head, the audience applauds for poor Candlefoot as he succeeded in his endeavors, and laughs as the spotlight disappears, leaving the tent in absolute darkness for just a moment. And when it appears once more, Candlefoot slowly and silently steps into frame. Throughout his entire performance, obviously, his face paint has been the same, and a rather melancholic appearance. But during his first vaudevillian half, that melancholy frown had an ironic twist to it. But as he steps forward now, the music, minor instead of major key, that frown takes on a different feeling. no longer feeling ironic. With graceful and exaggerated gestures, he masterfully conveys emotion without uttering a single word, his body becoming a canvas for storytelling, as he mimes a tale of love and loss. Invisible walls, imaginary objects, fictional companions, they all come to silent life through him. He creates a world within the Big Top as vivid as it is silent. The audience is spellbound, captivated, hanging onto every movement, every gesture, every expression, every twist of his invisible reality. Over the next 5 to 8 minutes, gasps, sobs, laughter are the only soundtrack to his routine. And by the end of his performance, there are quiet, invisible threads connecting members of the audience, all similarly bound in this silent moment. And as the silent counterpart to Palasha's final note of longing, Candlefoot reaches out to someone in front of him as the light cuts. And there are sniffles and whispers as a final round of applause for Candlefoot. This one, it is not thunderous. It's hard to be. No, I mean, it's close to that. It's just not as, you know, thunderous as the previous ones because people are overtaken with this emotion. As the lights come on once again, Mr. Witch descends back to where he started at the beginning of the show. Gentlefolk, as we draw to the conclusion of the extravaganza and the halfway point of our evening, we at the Witchlight Carnival would like to draw a little magic from you all, if we might. Though we performers weave wonder for you every night, we are not the only weavers or dreamers. Is there anyone in the audience who wishes to perform and delight?
Well, guys, I feel like I was kind of born for this, right? But I work here. It would be dumb. No. One of you guys should go, though. We need one of us to.
It's your only chance. Are you going to have another night off?
Probably not.
So live it up.
Go we can it. Always make you a little fancier.
You do have you
a bit of spark.
And I will, okay, simply out of character, out of DM, just draw attention to the fact that not a mere 45 minutes ago, the lot of you, perhaps minus one, all performed for a crowd quite well together.
Ellen? Do you want to try lifting me in one hand?
I was just trying to figure out what the hell that was about.
Oh, come on. Let's just do it.
Do what?
As Rot stands up. Do we have a volunteer? As Mr. Light jumps down from the ring, which was still about 12 feet in the air, and he jumps into a perfect curtsying position and stands and walks over to you with a exaggerated flourish, the mirror suit he's wearing catching every bit of light, blinding people temporarily.
Not doing this by myself. Get over here. And she's going to very dramatically put her clawed, ringed hand in his.
Oh, did I hear correctly? Gentlefolk, we have a wonderful surprise for you. Not only one volunteer, but multiple, do I hear? And he, you see as his eyes flick onto the two of you, Otto and Gromp. Hmm?
Yeah, teamwork, team building exercise. That's what we'll do.
Wonderful! I, for one, am simply ecstatic to see what these three? How many of you will there be?
Ellen, come on!
I guess he's going.
Five performers! Wonderful!
The audience.
Okay, I'm coming! Yes.
What are they gonna do, Mom? I'm not sure. Let's wait and see.
Here is what I would like from all of you. As you start to approach, Mr. Light joins your little group walking. What type of music and lighting will you be needing? Will this be a dramatic affair or a comedic?
We don't need music. You know I got that covered, Mr. Light. Come on.
For a bit of drama.
Loath to offend. Drama. Drama it is. I am a fan.
And he gives a little indication to the person working the spotlight and the pixies that are flying above, providing ambiance as they start to prepare themselves. As the audience waits with a different type of anticipation right now, I think each of you knows the type of anticipation I'm describing. There is a difference between the anticipation you feel waiting to see a professional perform something you know is going to be brilliant, compared to the anticipation you feel when a amateur begins to do something. You have a little bit of that, or the audience is feeling a little bit of that nervousness in their stomach for you, that sympathetic nerve. How will they do? So here is what I would like for you all. I would like first for you to describe what you are going to attempt to do. We are then going to roll a group performance check, and depending on the success level, you will then describe to me again what you actually do.
All right, huddle up, Ping, and just meh.
Take as much time as you need to plan this.
Thanks.
What are we doing?
Oh, shit, I hoped you had an idea. I don't fucking know. I am now feeling very sheepish about this whole situation.
No. We got it. We just gotta think about what we're gonna do. We worked well outside earlier. We made some money. I've got balls.
Can you juggle things that are on fire?
I could try.
Let's try.
Hey, Rot and Melon, do you guys still have the balls from before that I gave you?
You gave us balls?
Yeah, when we were in the tent, when we were in Otto's place.
Oh, Melon, you must have those. Are they in your pockets?
No, I don't have those.
In your pockets.
But
the non-food orbs in your pockets.
Why do I keep non-food?
I'll reach into his back pocket and grab them. Okay, I'll take care of it. You're all good.
Oh, if it isn't evident, Melon is fucking terrified.
Melon, do you think you can stand very still and hold me up high?
I've done it before, but yeah.
Maybe Bodhi can catch me if I fall?
Well, for sure. I've got your back. Just don't ask me to dance.
Nope.
And Bodhi, do you maybe, while they're doing that, want to play an instrument? And I'll pull out some little drums, if you're interested.
Oh, I fucking love drums. Hell yeah, let's go!
So, we will be playing.
But I'll also catch you if you fall. Just so you know, bro. I got you.
We'll be playing, Otto will juggle, and you will do the whatever acrobatics you're planning on doing.
think it's just going to be a bit of magic. No acrobatics involved, except for balancing on Alianan's hands.
Wonderful. Right. So.
Okay, guys.
Oh, go ahead.
I just want to say, you all got this. And I'm going to wink at Otto and Melon and Rot, casting Bardic Inspiration for them.
That does.
Gives you a plus D6, I believe, at level 1.
Hmm.
Was that all of your uses of Bardic Inspiration for the day? Fuck yeah.
Yep.
Good use.
Yeah, yeah. Not a bad use.
Yeah! Let's go!
As your Let's huddle go! Kind of breaks up, Gromp, you look back at Mr. Light, who gives you a little gesture. And as you kind of look at him for a second, he mouths to you, "Give an introduction."
Welcome, one and all. What you are about to see will cause wonder in the eyes and joy in the heart. Please give a round of applause for the amazing... Hey guys, what's our name? Performers!
Okay.
I was like, that's such a great moment for picking your group name.
No, actually, can we think about this for just a second?
Please, please, out of character.
Huddle again!
If you look at Melon, he's like a terrified elementary school kid who is stage fright.
So, Gromp, in the middle of the amazing, what are we called? And Otto calls for another huddle. So, immediately after you guys broke up.
1 second, guys.
You get a little titter of laughter from the audience.
We'll try to ham it up and make it comedic.
We're new at this. Sorry, everybody.
We okay. know.
I like you. All right, what are we called?
No shoes, no shirt, no service.
But that's why you get kicked out of bars.
Do you have shoes, though?
I can't wear shoes.
Yeah. They don't have shoes. They don't have shoes. They don't have shoes. I don't have shoes.
It's true. I am not wearing shoes.
It's great, too, because you all are huddled up. So as Melon looks down, there's just a circle of rabbit feet and lion feet and clawed feet and stump feet and bugbear feet.
And just because we're looking at feet, Rot has like two like semi-velociraptor talons as her big toes.
I'll be just a second. Sorry.
Should we be called the Funny Feet?
No, I will kill myself before I let myself be called that group name.
So the Fun Feet?
No.
Fantastic Feet?
Well, we need to talk about... We're going to have a talk, okay? Later. But, well, we're all kind of beast people.
Yes, so what are you getting
Fantastic
at?
Beasts.
Alright, we can do that.
That's copyright, I think.
Yeah, there is...
As long as you don't add on.
As soon as you suggest it, there is an immediate just pop-up. This title, this group name has been copyrighted. Please try again.
We're not going to give that person any more money. The wild
things.
Yeah, that works.
The wild things.
The wild things, with an E.
And as we break up the group...
Where's the E? After wild. I was trying to find what letter you replaced with E. I was like...
It's in front of the W.
The wild things? The wild fangs? Like...
It's with the wild fangs.
Fangs. The wild fangs. There you go.
Lauren, see? You let the cat in. You let the cat there.
Yeah, I had to deal with cat stuff as well.
Oh, both. Mm-hmm. We are having a technical pause
We love our animals.
Hold on.
Yeah, cat stuff.
All right, so Grom.
I'm gonna bring Melon back in. Melon, buddy, we're gonna be called the Wild Things, okay? That's our name.
Can I hear a big round of applause for the Wild Things?
And after all the anticipation, there is a round of applause for you all. Can I get from each of you a performance check? The result is yet. We're going to do a little stream theatrics here. Has everyone rolled? Wonderful.
I'm going to have a bardic inspiration to that just because.
That's probably what it was used for. Because this is a group check, so even if you think you succeeded, getting extra will help balance out any potential low rolls. All right, so if everyone has rolled, could you all please, those of you who are players, close your eyes for just a moment. Those of you who are watching the stream, the DC for this particular challenge is 13. All right. You can all open your eyes.
Bodhi,
what did you get?
A 16.
Gromp, what did you get?
A 20, of course.
Rot?
3.
23. Melon?
Much like my counterpart, 23.
Holy crud. And Otto?
Using my bardic inspiration, 24.
Jeez. With all 20s minus 1, which was a 16, all 20s or higher, the DC, and the chat can back me up on this, was 14.
Yeah.
You all average about a 20 or a 21. So,
let me do the math real quick and actually get that average.
It's high. but
better than bad.
Given, let's say, 21 is the average result here. I asked you all to describe how you wanted it to go. But now that it's happening, knowing how well you do, all of you can feel free to join in here, narrate this particular performance that you all put on. Unless you want me to do it. I will take it over if you guys don't want, but I want to throw it to you first.
Go ahead. Stop, I'm trying to narrate.
Cats, man.
At least mine's not walking cats. On the keyboard.
She's a cat.
I think Rot is going to have Melon lift her up with his hands around her feet, so she's up there, quite tall, and she has her lyre, her hand harp, for this whole thing, and for a lot of it, she's got her wings that she's using to do balancing acts with, so they're giant and spread and flushed. And for a lot of it, she's also going to be using minor illusion because she can use it to make sound. So it's becoming like the background, like the extra music, I think. So all the instruments we don't have mixed with, because they're both cantrips, I think prestidigitation for like sparks and like wafting little winds and just like the glitter all around.
4 luck points. I can hear that cat so clearly. Anyone else?
Otto, would you like to go?
What'd you say, Grump?
Would you like to narrate what you're doing? Because I'm going to add to yours while you're going.
All right. Otto walks up. Not really used to being on the big stage, but it feels natural to him. So he takes him out. Starts throwing up one, adds another one, as the third one, and now has balancing five or six balls, I think. And at this point in time, I'm going around, going in a circle, and throwing them up, and taking one with my ear and still using it to balance it up, and just doing all of this, and actually just a big smile on my face, and I call for Rot to light them up.
And Rot is going to use her breath weapon, actually, as the top one like hits like in front of her. When he tosses up high, she uses her breath weapon to light them all up.
As Otto calls, Rot, light them up. You hear a, what? As the gout of flame begins to catch them, there are gasps and applause and cheers from all around. That is 3 luck points to you, Otto. Beautiful. Love it. Anyone else want to add?
And although I have dreamed of performing, and this is perhaps my dream stage to perform on, I really take a background role and just play as best I can and try to give them the spotlight and stand in the back with Bodhi and just jam out.
Yeah, that's what Bodhi's doing, is he's taking a back seat, so seeing everyone actually enjoying themselves. He's just providing that drum beat. He's getting into it, bobbing his head, moving his shell just a little bit, keeping an eye on Rot, but just enjoying it.
As the two of you are providing perfect, like, beat-for-beat musical experiences based off of what is happening. When the juggling balls were lit aflame, the drum roll and the music turning dramatic and suspenseful, the carnival staff who are working the event begin to help with the lighting coming in and going off at the right time, actually taking a little bit of the light off of Otto so that the flames are even more vibrant. The musicians who were accompanying Palasha, who were accompanying Burley's performance, not Candlefoot's, all start following the beat that Bodhi is laying down and the melody that is being played by Gromp from off in the wings, and it begins to build and build and build. The audience is eating up this performance. Melon, was there anything you wanted to add?
Well,
you could probably throw me if you wanted.
Oh, no. I was about to say something. Well, he's just holding Rot. I imagine he's probably moving her very Globetrotters-esque. So it's around, it's like, oh, right? And then doing weird shit, like behind, quick flip, and then like around the back.
As you all are doing this, the music led by Gromp, being followed by all the additional musicians, like a improv jazz troupe that is able to read each other. Gromp, you start to build to a crescendo. The musicians begin to do the same. The lights follow suit. What do you do for your final moment, your final pose, as you all go to strike in anticipation of applause? I saw Rot's hand first, then we'll do Otto.
I think when it hits the final beat, she's going to use a combination of minor illusion and disguise self and explode, essentially, in confetti. And all of a sudden, Mr. Light is standing there.
Beautiful. Otto. So we'll actually jump to yours. Even though you said it first, Rot, yours will be the last part. Otto.
Otto is going to throw them all up, and using the bow and arrow set that he still has on him from earlier today, take it and shoot it through all of them.
Not with that high a performance check, since this is performance and not violence, no need to even make an attack roll. Skewer them all. Melon.
I'm probably just trying to back up Rot and whatever they're doing.
So probably just raising the hand straight overhead as Bodhi, and Gromp, you two lead the musicians to this crescendo. And then as Rot does this trick and drops down behind Melon, just as a classic magician, just like, you know, deposits the unseen item. Mr. Light, being such an experienced carnival performer, sees what you're going for. And as you explode into confetti, dropping down behind Melon, you feel a pair of light hands push on your shoulders as he leaps onto your hands, surprisingly light for his size, being a lithe elf. And as the confetti falls away, he is standing in the center. The audience erupts in applause, so loud that you see heads poking in through the main tent flap trying to see what was happening. Burly, Candlefoot, and Palasha off in the wings, the clamshell open, are all cheering for you all. Gentlefolk, keep it going for the Wild Things! Absolute joyful exuberance at the end of your performance. As Mr. Light descends and begins to close the performance, you all start to make your way out as the audience is starting to descend from the tiered benches. Each one of you, as you are passed, is approached by dozens of patrons. That was amazing. I've never seen anything like it. You should be sure to do that again. It was the best. I would come every season to see you all.
That was so good. How did you do that, Bart? Where you disappeared and Mr. Light was where you were?
Each of you is thronged with adoring fans. Melon, you are approached by Burly. Pumpkinhead still on.
That was good. That was really good. You've got a future in it, you know.
Well, he's going to say thanks. I think he's more focused on the pumpkin.
As he kind of sees you staring at it.
It's like I'm staring at it because he still has the pumpkin on his head or no.
You know what?
No. It looks like I'm making eye contact, but it's like at this forehead.
He puts it on your head.
You've earned it for tonight. Good job, Wild Things. Can't wait to see more from you.
Don't eat it. It's a gift.
Bishen.
No.
Bishen, you get to see that? I don't know if she got to see it, Otto.
Well, wait, what'd you say?
Remember earlier tonight when that little girl ran up?
Your friend, your number one fan. Oh, she missed it.
I know. It's okay. It doesn't really matter that much to me. I just kind of wish she could have saw it.
It means something if it matters to you.
No, it's really not a big deal, but I'll...
As you're saying that, Grump, you hear the familiar little voice.
Still smooth, out of the way! Move!
And pushing through the tiny little gnome girl, Grump! As she runs up to you and wraps herself around, you know, your calf and up to your, like, mid-thigh, basically.
You did so good! I knew you could do it!
I'll pick her up and give her a full hug. Thanks, Bishen.
When I saw you were up there, I was so nervous and I was so excited. I knew you could do it. I knew you could do it.
And like she's legitimately wiping away like little excited tears.
You're just the best, Gromp, and you're my hero. And I knew that you could do it if you were given the chance.
You really don't know how much that means to me, Bishen. Nope. Just finish hugging her and set her down.
You don't know how much you mean to me.
I'm gonna go get some candy there.
You mean a lot to her, but kid's got priorities.
At least she got your hug first before she went and got candy.
Yeah, true.
I told you that you were good and you were good at your job. So there you go.
Everybody was really, really good at their job, man. Like they've been here before, you know? Super great. And at that point, he's going to lean over to Gromp. Gromp, can you find a certain flower on my back for me real quick?
Yeah, what's it look like?
It's like really, really, really bright red, and it does this.
Yep, there.
You found it? And yeah. There's only like two. Okay, cool.
Do you want me to pluck it?
No, I got some shears, man. Oh, sorry.
You said during this, if you look at Melon, there's actually like a full head of him in his mane. And just other assorted flowers.
So, do you want me to put this one back, or do you want one of Melon's? Because he's looking.
No, I feel like I'm called to give this one away. And he pulls out some little shears here. Just nip him right there above his little nubbin. Yeah.
Okay. Here you go. Snipped it straight from the source. Did not pull it off first.
Man, I can see that you fucking pulled it off. Oh, it's all a fucking nightmare back there. You know how hard it is to maintain that particular area of my shell's ecosystem? It's okay, I'm just fucking with you, man. Thanks, man. he's gonna hobble over. This grows on my body, and it reminds me of you. And I think I was growing it for you. It's called Dragon's Breath. And you see this like big red flower that's got these petals that go all crazy. And he just gives it to you. Yeah, so, but I see that. Anyway, here you go. It's customary to give a performer a flower at the end of their set, I think.
Is it?
And this particular flower is very similar to the red ones in Melon's beard. It does look like a slightly different evolution of it, however.
Mane. No beard.
Mane. Down.
Yeah. Yeah. Down. Yeah.
And she's going to start ripping roses out of his hair. And give one to each of you.
Honestly, when he does that, you start to see more rapidly grow.
Oh. Thank you, Rot.
Thanks, Rot.
Oh, boy. Wait. They grow? You just cut them and then they fucking...
Yeah, he likes to grow them on me too, but I don't like it.
Do what?
You can grow... That's the coolest shit I've ever fucking seen, man.
As the...
Do what? Flower. What can I do?
Big flower.
It just happens, though.
You can do it on purpose. Give me one. Okay.
As the five of you are having this conversation, and each of you now holds at least one flower of one variety or another, prowling your direction, familiar with her midnight blue fur and large butterfly wings attached to her back and tentacles, or tendrils, rather, Dilligram approaches you, and with her deep velvety purr of a voice, she says, "Follow me. Management would like to see you."
Is everything okay, dear love?
We didn't take anything.
Not yet, at least.
No. The bosses are actually in quite good spirits.
And as she says that, you notice that, as you've seen a few times before tonight, with the lights and music growing brighter and sweeter and more beautiful, the carnival was a glorious thing when you first stepped in here. What you saw then is but a shadow compared to now. It is vibrant. It is bright. It is beautiful. The calliope and the other music, there is not a single sour note. There is nothing imperfect here. It is wondrous. And as she says, Matt, the bosses are actually in quite a good mood. She prowls towards the staff area you were just in, approaching the thorn wall which separates, as she does a little...
Okay, guys, this is our chance, okay? I think this could be our chance to get to you know where. So everyone, big smiles. It's showtime.
And as you say that, and we start to head that direction, that's where we're going to take our break. We will pick up with you all heading to meet Mr. Witch and Mr.
Good, because Noah went off to go get another little bite to eat as that was going on. He'll be back in just a second.
Oh no, I hope he follows in time. But we will pick up here in just about 15 minutes with you all meeting the owners of the Witchlight Carnival. So we will be back close to the top of the hour. So that is 7 o'clock Mountain, 8 o'clock Central, 9 o'clock Eastern. Be here. Can't wait to share more with you and see what happens at this meeting. See you all soon.
Yes. Bye.
And welcome back. Before we jump right back into the game, just a few announcements. Be sure to... Hi, Odin. What you doing up there, buddy?
Dog.
Oh, hi.
Dog. Look at the dog.
Be sure to check out all the other wonderful streams happening on Misty Mountain Streaming. Check the schedule. There's Two Nerds Play on Fridays, Cthulhu on... let me make sure I have the day right. I believe it was Tuesdays. Monday. Sorry. Cthulhu is Monday. We've got additional... Let me see here. Let me review things. We got a Spelljammer game going away. And be sure, if you're a Call of Cthulhu fan, to definitely check out the stream, because they do on Mondays very frequently give away Misty Mountain dice, which are amazing. So totally worth being in the stream for that. Mondays, thank you very much, Misty Mountain Streaming in the chat, for correcting me as I check my notes and scroll a little while up. But any other pending announcements relevant right now before we jump on back in? Well,
ready for more.
I was just gonna say, we love you.
Love you.
With the Mama Displacer Beast, Dearla, leading you all back into, unbeknownst to her, but back into the staff area, you are led once again through the wall of brambles into the circle of wagons. Still leaning against... or still present, now leaning against a rather ostentatious wagon, is the aging clown with the painted grin, smoking his bubble pipe. And Gromp, Otto, you know that this is Thacko, the clown. There's a geeky D&D reference for all of you old school players. Thacko, the clown. And he glares at you all. Just think of that... the particularly grumpy farmer hobbit, how he glares at the hobbits as they ride back into the Shire, just the...
As we pass, I use Minor Illusion to make his bubbles pop into smoke in different colors. Fucking whimsy.
Dearla ignores the clown and indicates the wagon against which Thacko is actually currently leaning.
They're inside, waiting for you.
Oh.
Any advice?
They're in
big smiles.
Wounds. It shouldn't be.
Oh, you mean him, not me?
Oh, apologies.
No, yeah, your advice is probably better.
Luckily, they're in good moods. I think they simply wish to congratulate you on your performance. I heard it was quite something. Wild things, huh?
You think it's caught on around the fair? Or?
I have already heard the name whispered and mentioned several times.
Did they mention my name?
I'm sure someone did. I can't be everywhere.
I'm on board with the t-shirt idea, by the way, Otto.
Hey, D?
Maybe you should start small with pins.
Hey, D?
I
just want to say that you're, like, super amazing and super great, and you're just really wonderful and really beautiful, and I want to thank you for all the hard work you do for the carnival. I'm petting her, by the way. I just want to let you know that.
She looks at your hand and gives a feline grin as she gives a mama cat grooming lick on the back of your scruff. You know, like pulling the excess skin a little bit with the pressure of it.
Now, get going before that good mood turns sour.
I do have a question, mostly for Brody / Lauren, actually. This is out right now. How is Otto's trip progressing after this duration? I'm kind of curious.
It's been an hour, or been about 45 minutes to an hour since you dosed him, for the record.
So he's not really on, like, a trip. Like, he's not having massive amounts of visualizations or anything like that. He's just having an elevated sense of existence, mostly. And that's pretty ongoing throughout the evening until he goes to bed, for the most part.
Take care of the dog.
And potentially after.
Thank you for taking care of the dog, Devin.
Fry's on the table.
What?
Fry's on the table.
Freya, my dog.
Okay, yes. So we need to take care of dog the for a minute. Table. Oh no!
That's okay. She's gone.
What is she's got?
It's basically a zoo in here.
You know what? This is why I love having cats.
I love my zoo. Hey, at least I can tell a dog down, and 9 out of 10 times they do it, as opposed to a cat who, like, what? See my butt?
Oh no! My cats get down.
Oh, that is nice.
You want to see my butt again? That's just
bad. They know.
Look at my butthole.
Look at it.
Our dog is half corgi, so it's kind of the same.
You want to say though? It was Ethan's butt. It's like, yeah, I'd look at that butt.
I'm shopping. One luck point to you, sir.
Oh, hell yes, I'll take that.
Compliment my butt for
wait,
luck
wait.
Point.
Flattery gets you everywhere?
Yes, it does.
Only why did it take me 3 campaign? Years to learn this?
Because it's only in this campaign. I am immune to bribery in every other campaign, but Wild Beyond the Witchlight, let's
die.
Go.
We all die in every other campaign.
Let's go. All right. So, Dearla is kind of does a circle and takes a lying down position. And you all are outside the extravagant cart that two of you know for a fact belongs to Mr. Witch and Light.
I sweep an extravagant bow using my wing to gesture the two Witchlight hands in before us.
Okay, Otto, let's go.
Ba, 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 ba. That's what I do on the door.
Oh no. You hear, oh good, come in. As you enter, you see two figures inside here. The first, a flamboyant but familiar elf. Mr. Witch is no longer, or Mr. Light, excuse me, is no longer dressed in the mirror suit that he was wearing, exchanging it for a striped and diamond patterned red and white ensemble. He still holds the scepter in his hand, the vein atop it, rotating slowly. Please come in. It's a delight to meet three of you and to meet two of you once again. I am Mr. Light, and this is my associate, Mr. Witch. The individual to whom he gestures is a stocky elf lounging on one of the bunks. He is currently wearing a suit with a long coat. None of it is nearly as eye-catching as what Mr. Light wears. You wouldn't be surprised if you saw a executive at a 18th century London bank wearing this attire, with a long coat with a window pane pattern, a burgundy waistcoat with a long gold pocket watch chain, rather loose fitting pants, black tie. And as you enter, he nods and doffs his top hat before popping it back on his head.
Mr. There. Witch, I just gotta say, I love your stopwatch.
Thanks, I suppose, Grump.
Yes. I do have to say, as you all take seats or stand, we are in your debts for
creating such a joyous and wonderful atmosphere. The carnival is simply electric tonight, and your performances at the extravaganza are the talk of the town. To which,
to enjoy being admired.
To which Mr. Witch gives a It is very clear which of these two is the face of the carnival and who handles the books, you know?
I was going to say, who holds the checkbook, right?
Mm-hmm.
Oh my gosh, they were roommates.
If you do not mind my asking, what brings the three of you, gesturing to Bodhi, Rot, and Melon, to the carnival? We are
both intrigued to learn your stories.
I'll turn and look at Bodhi, because honestly I've been kind of wondering the same thing.
Where does the story begin?
At the beginning.
And when you get to the end, stop.
Oh. Okay. Well, my story? Actually, it kind of began here. I got in. I came to here. And I... Well, see, so... I think I lost something here, but I think I gained something too. But maybe I lost what I had and I gained something. Anyway, so.
How long ago was this?
100 and something, maybe.
Wait. And he looks over at Mr. Witch, a grin growing on his face while Mr. Witch maintains a... I think, Mr. Witch, would you not agree? I remember you. You were much shorter then, but... Mr. Witch, is that the same
turtle whose image has now become part of the Bash a Beholder landscape?
Yes, that is the one. Was that you? Oh, don't worry about it. In fact, it has become a little bit of a local myth here. Nothing to fear.
Yes, that was me.
Well, you do have our sincerest apologies for anything that has gone missing from you, but if you entered without a ticket...
And he looks at
me. Hey, Dandelion!
There are forces at work on the other side that are entirely beyond our control.
The wheel of time turns ever on. What's lost is lost. What's gone is gone.
That. Oh, that explains why you came back. And what of the other two of you? What's your story?
Looking for Zabilna.
Oh, the patron of the carnival. Haven't heard from her in some time.
According to your unicorns, she's frozen in time by three hags.
And they look at each other.
Interesting.
Would you happen to know anything about this?
That is beyond our knowledge. Seeing as how...
Insight check!
Make it!
Is it really beyond your knowledge?
I look up. He has a decent charisma.
Mr. Light is
difficult for you to read, in that he is a consummate performer. And it's difficult to know where the performance ends and where reality begins sometimes. So you can't get too much of an idea out of that.
Well, with this knowledge in our pockets, I will admit we came in search of a way to travel to the Fey realm.
And they look at each other. Interesting. Well, what of the two of you, then, looking at Otto and Gromp?
We are deeply curious as to how you disappeared like Lord, how you two got to the night off.
Honestly, I thought that you gave us the ticket.
No, not us. We do not begrudge you the night off, please understand. We are simply curious.
Well, there was a fairy dragon that came down and told us that we had to go find these three. And when we went to go get them tickets to make sure they could get in, apparently there was some waiting for us by some mysterious benefactor, I guess. We just assumed it was you.
Out of character, I think that you guys know it was a man named Madrick. It was written on the...
It was mentioned. Note.
I pull out the two pieces of paper we have that tells we have the night off and hand it to him.
Cool.
Shows it to Mr. Witch, who gives a shake of his head while looking at it.
There's neither of our scripts written upon here. As I say, neither of us begrudges you the evening off, and seeing as how you performed so magnificently, I think we can hardly even consider it a night off. That was, and if you hadn't had the night off prior, I would certainly give it to you now. We are in your debt for this incredible atmosphere. It's going to be such a wonderful conclusion to the night. And Mr. Light is just beaming with joy. What I will say with that insight check that you got, Rot, is that Mr. Light seems incredibly happy about happiness. Providing joy, sharing joy, delights him. And the two of you who work there know this for an absolute fact. It is not in question. It is not a secret part of his personality. Making others happy is what he loves.
And Mr. Light, we were talking before we got here. I think... You know, I know I'm playing backup right now, and Otto's on the side. I was thinking maybe if you want some more happiness in the future, you know, we could have an act. Just something to mull over for a while, and there's no rush, really.
With advantage, make me a persuasion check.
Then roll another character who actually wants to go to the Feywild.
What was the total?
18.
I think that is something that Mr. Witch and I will have to discuss when our schedules allow, not during the middle of a run, but our next break. Between locations, we shall have to speak of it. Who knows what might happen?
No, I am curious. Mentioned being in our debt, but I also know that it's very rare for anything to come free. Is there anything that we can do for you to facilitate a possible Fey crossing?
they look at each other. And Mr. Witch leans forward on the bunk a little bit.
While all answers are replies, not all replies are answers. And I regret to inform you that my reply to the question of the Fey Crossing will not be an answer.
Mr. Light leans back a little, peering through you all through the open door, and gives a little nod.
Dila will show you all out of the staff area. You, again, have our thanks, and for such a wonderful performance. Please, stop by Thacko on your way out. Tell him that we sent you. He will make you an animal balloon of your choice. No charge.
And that is the end of your debt to us?
Yes.
A balloon animal.
I don't mean to butt in, but the balloon animals here are really fucking cool. Otto got one last week because they made an extra. It was a source of fun for hours. That being said, not a great, but yeah.
I sincerely hope you enjoy the remainder of the carnival evening. See you all, I do sincerely hope, at the crowning of the Witchlight Monarch, if you have not seen before. It is a wonderful experience. Ta-ta for now.
Dearla prowls up to the steps of the cart.
Come along now.
Going to go, but very reluctantly.
I'm going to go, but very confusedly.
As the last of you steps onto the steps leading down the wagon, Mr. Witch just gives a and the door.
I can't tell if that went well or very, very poorly, to be honest.
I think somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
I very rarely see Mr. Light this happy. I think it went pretty well.
Is there a prize for being crowned the Witchlight Monarch?
Yeah, there's got to be, right?
It's a wish, I believe.
A wish?
Oh, no, that worked.
Any wish?
A wish. That means if we want to know where the Fey Crossing is, one of us has to win that thing.
And you do know how we win that, right?
No, tell me.
No.
By having the most fun, of course.
Oh, that's going to be Otto.
You hear the low purring voice of Dearla as she leads you a little off course of where you expect she would have led you to return to the carnival grounds. If I may make a suggestion.
Yeah.
She leads you all off a little, away from Thacko, away from the wagon of Mr. Witch and Mr. Light. Once she gets there,
Mr. Witch and Light know more than they are letting on, I'm sure of it.
Let me put on my surprised face.
Bad things have been happening around the carnival for some time. People and things going,
and she pauses,
missing. Mr. Switch and Light, their hands are tied by something. You all are the first people I have met who might be able to set things right.
Validation is lovely, but what's the advice?
The bosses are good men, but you will need leverage to make them spill the beans. I might suggest.
And she leans in a little bit more conspiratorially.
Mr. Witch's pocket watch. It is essential for the functioning of the carnival. Without it, everything grinds to a halt. I would suggest borrowing it, and
she gestures with one of her tentacles, or tendrils,
not stealing. Temporarily acquiring in order to exchange for information.
That is advice. But perhaps we have to discuss this advice over another food stall for Melon. I can hear his stomach from here.
Oh my god, I'm so hungry.
Well, before you go, then, if this is a course of action you wish to pursue, two things you should know. I'm sure you saw that Mr. Witch's pocket watch is attached by chain. It will not be a simple thing to remove. Additionally, the only time that Mr. Witch and Light are separated is during the crowning of the monarch. If there is anything that I, and maybe a few others, can do to help without risking our positions here, ask. I cannot risk losing my place here. If Star returns, it would be here, and I need to be here if she
comes
back.
How often do those lost things return?
Never.
Where do they go?
I do not know.
Woody, you lost something. You said so yourself. They go to the Feywild. Maybe we could stumble across them. A thought.
One way or the other. I hope you succeed. Come now, the joyful clown is staring.
And you notice that is true, that Thaco is stood up, puffing dramatically on his bubble pipe as he cocks an eyebrow your direction.
Minor illusion to make them pop into like sparks that'll like give him like that white flash in his eyes.
He just kind of grumbles and... And Dearla leads you back through the bramble wall, back into the orgy of the senses that is the Witchlight Carnival. The sounds, the smells, the sights, the tastes. And she gives you all a little bow and prowls back off towards the lost property wagon, leaving the five of you back amongst the crowds.
Lots to think about.
Get crowned. wish for watch.
That's not a bad idea.
We go to the feasting orchard and discuss this for a few minutes. Where?
Okay, Omar, let's go.
You are not allowed to participate in the eating competition again.
Well, why not?
You will vomit.
I mean, probably, but why not?
You are going to shit custard.
We'll see what the prize is at the very least.
I shit worse, and you know it.
That is, by the way, my new favorite insult. You shit custard.
Let's go back to the feasting orchard, because there's so much noise there, it'll cover any kind of conspiriting that we do.
Heading back to the feasting orchard is a half revolution around one of the circles forming the figure eight. It's not a terribly long walk, but your walk through the lanes is distinctly different than your previous ones, as now you are recognized as people point, comment, applaud, to themselves as you walk by, make encouraging comments, ask when your next show is.
If we can, I would have Otto find like some small bits of like rock or things that he can do a bit of juggling with and then throw up in the air so I can firebolt it with a cantrip out of my mouth, just to anytime we get stopped, just as a bit of showmanship.
Oh, I want to stop by at least two food vendors as we're passing through.
So I'm going to roll randomly more. For which ones you pass.
Eight, I need at least two.
One. Funny enough, another stall with cupcakes. These blue frosted.
Excellent.
So they are different from the previous cupcakes. And also a stall for the sugar glazed button mushrooms.
Excellent.
And the mushrooms are not
some more tickets.
Like the combination of the sweet and the savory, plus they are covered in this powdered sugar that you can't help. No matter how delicately you eat, actually, you can't help but get it on your face.
What's that?
Hypothetically.
But if your mouth is big enough, you can fit the whole thing in there with no droppage of powdered sugar.
You'd think.
Oh.
And yet always there is a dusting of powdered sugar. As part of the enchantment on these, they just are always a little messy.
I got three tickets. I got three stamps left.
Heading back to the feasting orchard, you can hear it once again as you approach. But as you enter, almost the entirety of the crowd, aside from those currently competing in another eating contest, turns to applaud you. You get about 20 people who just applaud the five of you as you walk in. You are local celebrities right now. The feasting orchard hasn't changed much in the last 2 hours or so. The same general vibe, new people, mostly the same musicians who were present before. One of them was one of the musicians at the Big Top Extravaganza who gives a acknowledgement as he continues on his lute, the little gnome still swinging from the branch of the pear tree, the one that you spoke with earlier, Gromp, and you are in the feasting orchard. There's the smell of flowers and mead and berry pie. There is the central feasting table for contests, but several other smaller picnic tables that could accommodate your group, a few of which are currently empty.
I will save a table. 5 minutes, meet here?
Yeah, I'm gonna go grab something to eat. I haven't had anything yet tonight.
And then find me something that's not sweet and is drinkable?
I think I can find that for you. I know just the spot.
Excellent. Nothing sweet. Please, nothing sweet.
Of course, of course.
Why don't you like sweet things?
She's going to flick out this really long forked tongue like a snake. She's tastes terrible.
That's so cool.
Grump, the...
Otto, that was really good, Otto.
The drink that comes to mind for you, Grump, is Fairy Bell Nectar. It is a harvested and derived from the Fairy Bell flower, but it... When distilled, it actually has a more of a savory flavor to it. More Malbec, less, you know, Moscato.
I will say, Melon probably followed him. It's like, oh, savory? Yes.
So, Rod, I got a question. Like, you were doing all that.
I thought you were going
to get food. I am, but I'm going to talk to you for a minute, because I got questions.
Go away.
Well, you know, you're up there.
Buddy, it's over.
And Melon's hand and stuff, and you were going all the poo, poo, pow, pow, pow. Like, where'd you learn your magic? Like I can't do that. So, you know, it's kind of cool to see someone.
Me neither, man.
Do that.
Guess I just know. How do you know how to walk?
Someone taught me how to walk?
Nobody taught me how to walk. Taught myself. How do you know how to breathe?
Yeah.
How do you know how to make your heart beat?
It kind of just does it on its own.
I guess for me, magic just kind of does it on its own. It feels like a heartbeat. Just know. And sometimes, know when you get stronger and then you can lift something heavier, or you can run farther, or you can shoot more flaming balls. All of a sudden, you can just do better. Sometimes I feel like I can just do better, and then I can do something new because I think about it enough and I feel like I can do it. But do you know what I hate?
Wizards?
You know what I hate? Wizards. I hate wizards. Because they've got these big libraries, and they say, look, if you read this book, you can cast this spell. So I go, can I read the book? And they go, are you a wizard? And I say, no, because I read books, and I can't do magic out of a book. I read it, and it's just words on a page. There's no magic in their books. They just look at the words, and then they can do magic. And how is that fair?
I yell from pretty far away getting food. They tip really well, though.
I don't care how well they tip. They won't let me in their library. They say I'm not a wizard. And they say I'm going to burn the whole place down.
Well, that's just fucking rude, man.
I think so, too. Thank you. I'm terribly rude. I don't care how well they tip. They won't tell me how to get magic out of their stupid books. So all I can do is go, I'm going to try really hard, and I'm going to make sparks. And she makes sparks. And they
won't. A few people
Thank
nearby.
You. Thank you.
You know what, man? You know what I think? I think you don't need their fucking books. I think the magic comes, like, from in you. I mean, the fact that you can see something in your mind or feel something in your body to just make it happen, they can't do that. They have to rely on something else. You got yourself, man.
Just their gatekeeping. I don't like that. It's not fair that they should be able to sit there in their comfy chairs with a book and go, and all of a sudden I can cast Fireball just because I read a book. And I wrote about Fireball in my stupid book. I'm going to set all of their books on fire, and then I'm going to take every book in their library and I'm going to put it in my library. I have a library.
As Rot goes on this little, like, after doing the sparks and getting a little bit aggressive and heated, you look to your side and you see a la The Incredibles, the neighbor kid, just standing there. Just a little human listening to this. I'm going to burn it. I'm going to burn them. I'm going to burn their books.
I'm going to turn around and I'm going to hold up my hand and I'm going to use Minor Illusion to, like, make a little dancing man in my hand. I'm going to go have fun. Thank you. Where are your parents?
That's the elite controlling all of the nation's wealth, man. That's fucking wizards.
Wizards, yeah. The top 5%, and I'm going to kill all... No.
You're awful. Man,
not...
But... Be the bigger person, you know, or dragon or whatever.
I don't need a booster seat. The bigger person who doesn't need a booster seat.
Can I just say how funny it would be if we need a backup character and they bring in a wizard?
Well, you hear I'm gonna have to kill one of you guys, so need this to happen. First one to die makes a wizard. Yeah, just can't be wrong.
You're immortal now.
From pretty far away. It's a get higher seat, not a booster seat. As I'm still trying to get food.
Are you more than 30 feet away?
Yes.
In that case, I'm not doing anything.
I'm also there with him. Doing absolutely nothing except waiting for this drink.
You get your, you each get your glass, which is actually a glass-blown flower bloom that is made in such a way that as the liquid pours in and fills up, it also fills into the petals of the glass, and it creates this swirling, dancing pattern of oranges and reds. And that is your fairy bloom.
Now, Gronk, correct me if I'm wrong, but you just came over here to get one for Rot, yes? I got one for myself.
I got one for myself as well. I got two.
Okay. Before we go, I'm going to
no punches in my card.
Take a sip at it real quick. Does this taste like something that Rot would actually like?
Would Rot like a Malbec with a slight bit of spice? Like a little bit of actual, not spices, but spice, like, you know, Scoville.
She likely would, yes.
That's a good one. There we go.
What do you think, Melon? You think she's gonna like this one?
Yes.
Okay, cool. M'lady.
Don't do that.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
That was terrible. How would you feel if you were a lady and somebody said that?
Yes. Then she does the Komodo dragon tongue thing into the drink.
So elegant.
Bode, are you hungry?
I need...
Oh, for sure, Mia. I am fucking starving, but I think I'll probably just make a nice caprese salad. Consume that while I'm journaling. Just really be in the moment right now.
All right. I'm going to get the things for a caprese. Is a caprese.
Oh, my fucking back, man. It's a whole garden back there. You know, just with the clip. I mean, it's not exactly caprese, but I can fake it well enough.
We're out of character. You were growing whole ass tomato plants back there.
Doesn't
Caprese
also mean mozzarella?
Little bitty ones. Listen, I'm lactose intolerant. We've been over this, man.
That is true.
That
is canon.
So, like I said, it's not exact, and maybe they're, you know, mushrooms right. That taste enough like tomatoes.
That was just me saying, it's like, I totally forgot that you did mention that. That is my bad.
It's okay. I'm not worried about it. You're not knowing my balance is okay, my dear.
Everyone take 2 luck points for various reasons, from previous episode callbacks to initiating great inter-character roleplay. Fantastic job, you guys are doing great. So 2 more luck points for everyone.
Well,
does everybody get to eat before our plotting?
Oh, I'm going to go get something to eat. I wanted to wait here with y'all just in case anything were to happen.
Hold the table. Way,
yeah. All right, I'll be back.
The two of us get this. Why don't you all go get something?
Lynn, where's your snack?
I've been eating constantly. I need finally something to drink.
I mean, I know that you've been eating constantly. Feeding you is a never-ending chore.
Yeah.
So it's
Otto would like to find protein because we've been on a fun little ride right now. It doesn't matter.
Protein's tough. In terms of the stalls here, they don't do.
Who's
it is. Mushrooms. It is pretty. Yeah. Other than like, it is a fairly vegan affair. But you can definitely
fried
find the savory mushrooms.
Yeah. I'm going to go find me some mushrooms because I'm hungry. I'm going to get one of those and I'm going to get something to drink. So that's 2 punches.
So everyone gets whatever they would like to eat or drink. Just take the appropriate number of punches out of your card.
Somebody else waiting for you.
While they're away, I'm going to be chatting with Rod. It's like, I know you asked me what I thought of them earlier. It's like, what do you think of them, though?
What I think of them?
Give a what?
No.
They seem entertaining, though.
I'm not denying that they're entertaining. There's a family that lives in the house a couple buildings down from our building. They have some dogs.
They're annoying, and I know it.
I know they're annoying, and they never stop barking.
I just want to eat one of them.
No, don't eat them.
Come on.
But do you remember when they were puppies? You could tell that they were gonna be something interesting because they had big, big feet, and they looked everywhere.
God, we had such big feet.
We're not talking about our feet. We're talking... That's interesting thing I'm feeling about them is I feel like they're big-footed puppies. Like it could be something really interesting in the right environment.
So we need to guide them.
But listen, no, Gromp was talking about having a show in the carnival. They're not coming with us. They don't want to come with us. They want to have a show in the carnival. I think at best we can maybe convince Bodhi to come with us because Bodhi's weird. Bodhi's weird. I don't know what vibe I get off of Bodhi. He's like, I lost something, but I found something. I'm like, then why are you here?
I don't know, but he's strong, though.
I think if I go, Bodhi, I need your help. I am so weak by myself. I will definitely perish in the terrible Feywild without you to guide me. He will definitely come with us. That's so easy.
Oh, no, the other tall one is like...
is his name. We're using people names.
I don't know his name.
Gromp?
Gromp, that one, yes.
Just said it.
Oh. He seems to be like a gelding.
Are you comparing horses and dogs to people now?
I know he's interested in you. He got
you hit your butt.
Oh, I don't know. What do I know?
Not I know, because you never look behind you. You're only looking for your next meal.
Yeah.
At that moment, but... Rod, can you make me a perception check really quick?
Sure. Nat 20.
You say to Melon, you never look behind you. And, you know, well, our whole body is how we communicate. And your eyes flicker following the gesture behind him. Just as part of the act of communicating as your eyes flicker. But you see something. Back amongst the trees that edge the feasting orchard, there is... what I can only describe to you as a detached shadow. A shadow without a source. A shadow that is not being splayed against any object, but standing, freestanding. It is of what looks like a feminine form with layered dresses or layered skirts, and wearing a mask of a bemused expression with a crescent moon around it. Just standing, not looking at you in particular, standing looking around the crowd. And as the gnome who is swinging on the pear tree right nearby, as the gnome swings back momentarily blocking your view. Gone.
I think in the moment she spotted that, anybody who was looking at her saw a huge change come over her. That she'd seen something interesting.
At this point, those of you who went to get food reconverge on the table.
I was going to say probably that immediate moment I see that change, because I'm barely attuned to it. You immediately turn around and probably don't see what you were looking at.
By the time you turn,
it's too late.
It's like her eyes get just giant and snake-slitted. And she leans forward and the wings come up like more claws than anything else. And then come down on the table in front of her like she's preparing to kind of spring over the table. And then as soon as it's gone, slowly come back and hook over her shoulders.
Sorry, what were we talking about?
What's wrong?
I was stretching.
Did you sniff rot?
I did.
What's wrong?
Yeah, I didn't.
Get your turtle nose away from me.
Hey, I don't need to be super close, so you know. Anyway, what I'm trying to be saying...
What are you implying?
You smell delightful, and it should be said, okay? There, I said it. You smell awesome. Fuck! Anyway, and also, what's wrong?
I thought I saw something. But I didn't. It was...
Did it have a pig face?
No, it had a moon face.
Oh, fuck. So many fucking faces, man. I don't know.
There's something...
I'm
strange in this neighborhood.
I saw a Kenku transform to another person.
What?
Yeah.
Like, now you saw that?
No, earlier when we were on the dragonflies. Remember, I told you.
Oh, yeah, I forgot.
This place.
Okay, okay. We're losing the thread of the plot. Now that everybody has their snacks and their drinks.
And I got some for you guys as well. And I'll hand the plate of mushrooms to both of them.
Take it, pass it down.
Honestly, Melon is still looking the direction you are. He isn't even looking at the food or his drink in the moment until otherwise stated. Because Rot expressed or did the thing. It's like, no, there's potentially something that way.
I'm going to very quietly, I'm going to actually telepathically. It was a shadow. Behind someone. It's the face of a moon and long robes. Mm. Your eyes open.
Mm. Yeah.
As I was saying, it sounds to me as though we have two options. Because we're in your debt. Have a balloon animal. What kind of balloon animals did we get, Ethan?
You didn't stop to get them.
Oh, you're right. I was too mad.
Yeah.
I just want to reiterate, the balloon animals are really good, and I don't think you should be hating on them as much as you are.
It's not that I'm hating on them. It's that they said, we're in your debt, have a balloon animal, and we brought life to the carnival, and they said, have a balloon animal. That's not
actually,
equal
they said
exchange.
That I might get a show and auto.
Okay. Great for you.
It is rich. Probably the greatest thing to ever happen in my entire life, maybe?
I'm so happy for you. I am thrilled in both of... Yes. All of my hearts are so happy for you.
All of your hearts?
Wait, did he say he's going to be getting his own show? The Wild Freaks are going to be getting their own show, everybody!
Oh, God.
You have more than one heart.
It's more... When you give someone a certain amount of service, you expect equal payment.
Hey, yo.
You work for the carnival, you getting your own show is wonderful, but here's the thing. I... Melon works for me.
Yep.
My bodyguard. I have another bodyguard who's been kidnapped by fairies.
For the second time.
Second time.
Oh my god.
At least we're assuming that's what happened because he just vanished.
Yeah, it's likely. It's happened the first time.
Just really like him. So, as wonderful as balloon animals are, I have the offer of favors, gold, spells, and a whole house, and my other bodyguard to retrieve from the Fey realm. A balloon animal isn't going to match those things.
Then I guess we're gonna have to get you there, huh?
That's the goal. Don't tell me about how great the balloon animals are. A house, Gromp. An entire house. And it has a garden.
With so many pumpkins.
So many pumpkins. And there's rats all over, and it's great.
I'm gonna need some air, and I take a step away, fighting back the urge to talk about the balloon animals. Just give me 1 second.
And in your head you hear, no balloon animals, not a one. A single one.
Sorry, I'm back. I just had to take care of some stuff internally.
I like that you said, okay, I'm back, and you like stepped away like 2 feet, just like...
All right.
I'm proud of you for taking your time you needed to center yourself, my dude. Way to advocate.
Thanks, man. You get me.
Yes.
Rot starts to wonder what would happen if she spoke in Bodhi's mind telepathically and told him she was God. She doesn't.
So you haven't listened this whole time, but now... Okay.
Resist the urge. That's going to be something fun for later.
For now, at least.
Now.
I'd like to say I am sorry I wasn't, I don't know, maybe taking this serious. I didn't realize what this meant for you. And I am sorry. I didn't know that you lost, you know, family like that.
No, not family. He's my bodyguard.
Yeah, but you, come on, you and Melon... Or like family. The
okay, Melon. Okay, listen. Melon may guard my body, but let's be honest. I'm looking after him.
Yeah.
What family does, though?
Not. This isn't about family.
Well, my Kaya's are. This is about family. Half, you know it, right?
This is about getting back what's mine and then getting more.
Can I ask you a question?
Yes, but I don't promise you an answer.
Most people around here don't. How much do you care about getting this bodyguard back? I mean, honestly, I see a lot of bodyguards come through this carnival even. They're pretty dispensable. And I mean no disrespect by this.
What kind of scale would you like on how much I want my bodyguard back?
I suppose I'd would prefer... more of a history as opposed to a number.
Can give you how useful he is. Or I can say he's kept me alive as long.
He's a part of us. Us. Us is the right word. He taught me that word. Yeah.
He means a lot to me. I would dearly like him back, and I want him back more than I want the house that was promised to me.
That and more than you wanted the balloon animals.
I want both of those a lot more than I want the balloon animals. Do you know what it's like to want something?
Yeah.
You want a show. You said that.
How much do you want to show?
A lot, I guess. I mean,
want it enough you would die for it.
Kill, even.
You would kill for it. Have you killed someone?
Hold on. Let him answer.
I haven't killed someone, and I guess I. When you say like that, I don't know what it means to want something that bad. I wouldn't kill for a show. I wouldn't hurt someone for that. You would do that for your bodyguard?
I would do that for a lot. Think, Romp. You don't know what it is to want something. You know what I think you could find? Came with us.
Came with you to the Fae?
Feywild.
True desire.
You could learn how to want something. That would make your show magnificent.
You think I could be back in time for the show?
I think you would be the show.
I am interested in what you say, but I'd have to talk to Otto first. I couldn't leave him here by himself.
It's a thought.
Could he accompany us? If I did go with you?
Not in a position to say no.
Everyone needs their first battle.
I've seen what's in his future. Apparently, it's murder, chaos, and flames.
I really do think that was a one-off. He's a great guy. It was the Hall of Illusions. Who knows? But okay, I'll talk to him.
You should talk to him. In the meantime, it sounds like we have two options. One, somebody wins the Monarch of the Fair. Get a wish. Apparently how things are going, and she takes a claw and she points at Melon and Otto. Some of you are having more fun than the rest of us. Not that I'm not having fun!
It's on, little man.
You are very stoic.
But I'm always having a great time because my joy starts from within the self.
Of course, but your joy is inside you and is not showing so much exteriorly.
Oh, I'm having a great fucking time watching everybody talk about shit.
I'm so happy for you! And she pulls out her gold star and she puts one on Bodhi. Having a great time! Back in the pants pocket.
Holy shit!
Nice fucking star, bro.
Fucking gold star!
Actually, out of character, I keep a tally of how many of these I have left.
Yeah.
How many do you have left, by the way?
16.
Nice. I haven't earned one yet.
Bodhi.
You haven't earned one yet.
Speaking of gold star, as he goes, fucking gold star! Just like you, Otter.
So cool! Now we're
star buddies. And star no buddy. Magic buddies. But hey, that doesn't make us any less great, though, I think. I can't make magic either.
I can't either. I know. Kinda hop on things. It's fun.
And your magic comes from within yourself, man, and how you put that out into the world. And we only get a little bit of it. Magic users get a lot of it, so it
means
kind of more niche for us.
We trade off by not having a very hard shell, because if you punch me, I die.
That is actually true. Yes. That is a fact.
Can I just say, out of character, at this time period, Mel doesn't believe he's magical.
Okay. Did he tell us that?
No.
But he did say
he doesn't believe he's magical.
Oh. All right. No magic bros.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Auto.
Mediocrity.
Yeah.
You know this place, yeah? Yeah. You know this place.
Uh-huh.
What is something really fun to do?
The swans.
Ooh.
Flying on the swans.
We're not even going to talk about stealing the pocket watch?
Wait, well, yeah, well...
I mean, I was thinking... Monarch Carnival, wish for pocket watch.
You could wish for the Fey Crossing Melon.
That's easier.
Oh, yeah, that.
Yeah, it's okay. You were going to get there, man.
Okay. Here's the thing. How about,
I'm proud of you.
Super easy plan. If none of us win Monarch of the Fair, we steal the pocket watch.
Yeah.
Okay, whatever.
All right.
You said don't do bad right now.
Here's the thing about that.
Borrow.
Yeah, because I still... This is the only place I live. Like, this is only me and Grop's home that we have. So, whether we find the Fae Crossing or not, we're all going to be together because... I'm not going to have a home to stay in. I'm not going to have a bunk to live in. I got to go back out there.
That would be a very bad look for us.
What's this?
And I don't want
you definitely
tired.
Wouldn't get your show then.
Not so bad.
I mean, it could be better. I miss my rock.
Here's... If it comes to stealing that, hey, that's a great rock, Otto, by the way.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no, Mel will not elaborate or acknowledge that.
Just in case it does come to that, I would be willing to help you, but I cannot be connected back to it.
Understand.
Otto, are you on the same page there?
Friends help friends.
If you can get me through that hedge, I think I can get it.
Bodhi?
Maybe.
What do you think?
I don't like really stealing shit, man. I like to...
It's not stealing, it's borrowing!
But... Again, it was borrowing, and we have a main game plan anyway. We're gonna
have lots of fun.
Yeah, I mean, I was out of
plan.
It's gonna be great, and then after that, or if and when that plan backfires, we can go to plan two or B, whatever you want to allot it.
Hey. Bodhi, thanks for giving us the choice between letters and numbers. I do appreciate that.
Hey, I don't want to judge or assume.
So
weird.
I think...
Oh, that was out loud. I'm so sorry.
You used your inside voice on the outside, and that's okay, because I'd like for you to tell the truth so I know where I stand with you. Which is barely not great, but we're working on it. But I got a gold star.
Nope. Mm-hmm. Ooh, swans. Let's go to swans and have lots of fun.
With the five of you, two of you prominently displaying gold stars.
Three, actually.
Three?
Grand Pass 1-2.
Three
they
of
were both
you.
Good not, at their job.
It's not
that's
quite
right,
as
that's
prominent.
True. Yeah. Oh. With three of you displaying your gold stars from Rot like badges of honor, and you head back out of the feasting orchard, back into the lands, and heading towards the swans. And with people still reveling in the excitement of your performance, cheering you, acknowledging you, recognizing you as you walk by, that is where the curtain will close for tonight.
Oh, come on!
And where
10 more minutes!
Next time. Yeah. Speaking of next time, friends, we are going to be off for 2 weeks. We've got next week off so that I can run 3 other games next week to rest my brain. And then the weekend after that, Lauren and I will be working at a convention here in Denver, so that's not really rest. But we will be back the first Sunday of August. All right, so please mark your calendars or watch for the announcements. We will be coming back to see how the two possible plans, plan 1 and B or plan A and 2, end up going for the wild things, as they are.
Okay, Ethan, you mean the first Saturday of August?
What did I say?
Sunday.
I did say Sunday. Scratch that. First Saturday of August.
There we go.
Good shout.
First Sunday of August is the Renaissance Fair. My bad, got that mixed up. But
Renfair.
Better believe it. Everyone, I cannot thank you all enough for joining us, for cheering on their successes, for feeling the emotions with them. We appreciate your company. We appreciate you. Please remember to hydrate. Please remember to do something good for yourself this weekend. You deserve it. Yeah. Take care of yourself, whether that's reading a book, taking a bath, whatever, playing your favorite video game. You deserve it. Take the time for yourself. We love you all. Thank you so much, Sally Quinn, for blowing up the chat. Thank you, everyone who has been here this whole time. Smallville, JN Man, lots of different faces in here. I hope to see more of you in the chat next time. But take care of yourselves. We love you. Stick around for just a minute until we get a raid going so we can show some other people some love. Take care of yourselves and see you in a little while.
Good night. Bye.